Hello fellow teachers, today we are going to discuss about the topic work and work education. Myself, I am Dr. Sonal Chhabra, an assistant professor in Rawal College of Education. Before we go further and try to understand that what is work education and what is the importance of work education in education of children, let's understand the word work. Now, work is a word which seems to be very simple. It doesn't seem to denote something extraordinary, and when we talk in terms of science, it's something which is the result of some kind of force or some kind of action that something is done. But when it comes to real life, then work is something which is driven by the physical labor. So if you are doing some kind of physical labor in a specific direction which is having an effect towards the production for oneself or for a societal cause, then it is considered to be a work. Let's understand this from an example. That let's say if we are moving outside and we see a sweeper who is sweeping the roads, or if we move inside our homes and if our mother is cooking for me, then both these conditions are the conditions of work, because you are doing something, you are producing something, and you are producing for a societal cause. See, if the sweeper is working on the street, he is cleaning the street or she is cleaning the street, she is contributing to the cleanliness of the area. So that's labor, that's physical labor, and that's resulting into work because something is being done. Now when we move inside and when we look at our mother, since she is cooking for the whole family and the other family members are then free to do some other kind of work, so in a way she is also doing some kind of work which is having a societal effect. Maybe it seems to be that it's just going to have an effect on the family, but when you look at in the longer run, it's having an effect on the whole society. Because when she's cooking for the family, when she's taking care of the family, when she's cleaning the house or sweeping the house, then she is freeing the other family members for doing some other kind of work. See, if she is not going to do that work, then the male of the house or the other working members of the family, working in the sense people who are going outside and working, they are going to be the ones who are going to work inside the house. Now, once they work inside the house, they won't be able to go outside, or even if they go out, they won't be able to do that work so productively. So that is why even her working inside the house is considered to be work, because that's going to have an effect on the society. So any form of physical labor which is going to have an effect of production for either for your own self or for the societal cause, it is considered to be work. Now work also denotes those activities in which there is some kind of physical labor and which fulfills our responsibilities towards self, society and other people. That's almost a repetition of what we discussed earlier, that it's having a connotation that there are going to be three factors. So when you're producing something, when you're doing some kind of physical labor which is fulfilling our responsibilities for one's own self, for the society and for other people. I'm going to just repeat the portion which I was discussing earlier. We are going to understand work from the terms of physical labor. Now let's move to another definition, which is talking in terms of the contribution it is making. So work is meaning some activities which are related to the physical labor and which fulfill our responsibilities towards three aspects. One is the self, the second is the society, and the third is the other people. So these are three contributors, or there are three benefiters rather than contributors. These are going to be the three benefactors of the work which is being done by an individual. So if I am working, I am contributing towards self, I am contributing towards society, and I am contributing towards other people at large. So the work is going to have three benefactors: self, society and other people. Now let's move further and try to understand what is this importance of work and labor. See, labor, as soon as we hear this term, we always think of the physical labor and we always think of those people who are working physically. But yes, to an extent it is true that they are working physically to earn their livelihood. But when it comes to the normal people or normal individuals or normal children also, every activity of work and labor has an effect on the individual. So it is important for all of us to understand and realize the importance of work and labor. Now man's life is dependent on physical labor. If you do not engage in physical labor, you won't be able to do much activities in life. Right from waking up in the morning to having your morning chores and then going to school or college or whatever occupation you are going for, you are engaged in some or the other kind of physical labor. So that is some importance. This importance would be realized more by people who unfortunately do not engage in or cannot engage in physical labor. So only for, not just for contributing, but even for living a normal life, you need to depend on physical labor. And you, that's why you need to keep your body also fit so that you engage in some or the other kind of physical labor. Now, work and human life, from the above example, we can very well understand that work and human life cannot be seen as two separate things. You cannot understand man without human life and work without human life. Human life without work and work without human life. So for understanding both, you need to realize that they both are connected to each other, they both are dependent on each other, and they both are interrelated to each other. If you're engaging in work, it's going to have an impact on the human life. And if we talk about the human life, they cannot survive without some kind of work. So these two are interrelated and interdependent on each other. Now moving further, we also realize that labor is done with an expectation of money, which is related to livelihood. Now this is coming to the first example which we were talking of, that when we are engaging in labor, when we see those sweepers or laborers who are masons who are working on the buildings, on the construction of the buildings, they are engaging in labor for earning their livelihood. So livelihood and labor are again connected to each other. So man's life is dependent on physical labor for carrying out the normal daily life also. Then they are both interdependent, interrelated to each other. And moving further, we realize that labor is also entangled or coiled with the physical labor which we are doing is also coiled with the livelihood which one is engaging in. So you to earn the money also, you need to put in some kind of physical labor. The kind of physical labor we are going to put in or the amount of physical labor we are going to put in may be different. Somebody may be sitting on the chair and doing some kind of work, and the others may be working with their hands and then they are doing those works. So both of them are engaging in labor, but the labor is of different nature. So even for the people who are sitting on the chair and doing some kind of work, otherwise it seems that they are not doing physically too many things. But once they are starting from home and they are reaching to their workplace, they are engaging in physical labor. So one can see that these are connected, related to each other, and you cannot separate the two things and see them. Moving further, production done for the society through labor enriches the human life. Now this is very obvious thing, that whatever production is being done for the society through labor, through some kind of labor, any kind of labor, the physical labor or the mental labor, it is going to enrich the human life. Now, let's just take some basic examples only. That again, I'm coming to that standard example of somebody who is engaging in sweeping the roads. One is engaging the sweeping the roads, the person may be earning a livelihood out of that, but when you're engaging in the sweeping the roads and you're cleaning the roads, you are making the human life of other individuals better. Because aesthetically the roads are going to look better, health and hygiene is going to be better if the roads are clean and there is less of garbage. So you are making the human life better, you are enriching the human life. This is the simplest example which we have taken. There are so many other examples. The mother is cooking in the kitchen, she is cooking tasty dishes, again the human life is being enriched. So whatever physical labor you engage in, if you are leading to some kind of production, then it's enriching the human life. Again, another way of looking at it could be that physical labor opens new vistas of happiness, contentment, and pleasure. So it is not just to do with the production activity. Physical labor also helps in having some kind of happiness. You are more contented with yourself. You feel the pleasure when you are engaging in physical labor. Now you would have realized this kind of thing, that if you are sitting on the sofa for the whole day and you are not engaging in any kind of physical activity, you feel dull. You eventually, by the end of probably 2 hours, for somebody it may be 3, for somebody it may be 4 hours, but at the end you're going to feel dragged, you're going to feel sulky, and you're not going to feel nice about it. But once you engage in some kind of physical labor, maybe just cleaning up your room, or maybe just going to the garden and doing some kind of gardening there, you feel happy because you get connected with the nature, your body is moving. So you feel that contentment in yourself that you have done something for the good of the society or the something for good of yourself also. And that's why you feel that pleasure. So work or labor is not just to do with livelihood or making others' lives better, it is for your own happiness also, it's for your own contentment also, and eventually the pleasure which you get out of once you have engaged in some kind of physical labor. Moving further, physical labor is essential for good physical and mental health also. So if you are engaged physically, as we said earlier also, that once we are engaging in physical labor, you see that you're more happy, you're more contented, and you feel that pleasure in yourself. So in the same breath, I would say that it's good for your physical and mental health also. If you're not engaging in physical labor, you're physically also, your body gets slagged, you are not feeling energetic, and you would find that there are certain, so many conditions which are getting associated with your body. But if you're engaging in physical labor, then these conditions get cut down. And the same way, it is contributing to the mental health also, because once you're occupied, your mind also knows where to go, what to think and what not to think. But if the way we say that an idol's mind is a devil's mind, so you're not going to have good thoughts, you're not going to have positive thoughts if you're being slacky and if you're not engaging in physical activities. You look around yourself, you see people who are more busy are generally more happy. But people who are less busy or they have lesser things to do, they are the ones generally who do not feel that kind of contentment in life, and they may suffer from some kind of mental issues also. So physical labor is not just contributing to the production, it is contributing to the satisfaction, it is contributing to the happiness of the individual, it's contributing to the physical and the mental health of the individual, it is enriching the society by ways, yes, it's a means of livelihood also. So all these points help us understand and acknowledge the fact that work and labor are related to each other, and we need to understand that this is going to go a long way in understanding how the individual goes about it. Now let us understand, we have understood what work is, what labor is, and how they are connected to each other. Now let's understand this word work education, which has been cropping up instantaneously in some or the other way in our discussions, in our seminars and other things, that some kind of work education should be incorporated in the education of the children. And it's nothing new about it. From the times of immemorial, I mean, even if you talk in terms of the Nayi Taleem, which was being proposed by Mahatma Gandhiji, and there have been several other theorists also who have been saying about this thing, that you should be incorporating work education in the normal education system, because that's going to give an exposure to the children. But before moving further, that why do we need to include it, let's understand that what is work education. Now, work education is considered to be a purposeful and meaningful physical activity or physical labor, which is organized as the inherent part of educational process. So, from this definition, one can understand that it is taking it to be an inherent part of the educational process. So, if you make work education as an inherent part of educational process, everything is going to revolve around that, and we are going to benefit a lot out of it. So, it has to be considered in that way, that it is a purposeful activity, and it's not just an activity which has been added to the educational process. You need to acknowledge, appreciate that it's a purposeful and meaningful physical labor which is happening there. You're engaging the children in some or the other kind of physical labor, but it is purposeful and it is having some kind of meaning. So, that's going to give more meaning to the education which the children are having in their normal schools or normal day-to-day educational life. Now, it also establishes coordination in hand and brain. That's the beauty of work education, because it helps us to establish that kind of coordination between hand and brain. Now, everybody has been saying, even Einstein has said, that no mental activity is possible to be beneficial until and unless it is accompanied by a physical activity. So, if you're going to have both these things together going on, then it's going to have a better effect on the cognitive development of the child also. So, if the child, let's say there are two situations, there is in one situation a child is learning, but he is engaging only in the mental activities which are being done in the class. And then there is another option, another situation where the child is engaging in activity and simultaneously he is engaging in the theory classes also. Now here what is happening in the second situation, that since the child is engaging in both physical and mental activity, therefore that coordination between hand and brain is going to be better, and that's going to lead to better cognitive development of children in general and a better life in general, because then you're going to have a control of the things. So, once you are able to control those aspects of your life, obviously your life is going to be better, because then it's in your control. Whatever activity you are engaging in, you're not getting swayed by whatever is happening around, or you're not getting swayed by the fads and the fashions. You are more in control of yourself. Moving further, It is based on the principle of learning and doing. It's very obvious that work education is based on the principle of learning by doing. So you're doing a thing and you're learning out of it. Now, that doesn't mean that the whole class is going to be just doing something and you're leaving the children on your own, on their own, that they're going to learn out of it. Obviously, the teacher is there and she is an added feature to it, and she would help understand the children that once they are engaging in physical activity, how are they learning from it? So, from simple experiments or simple activities like gardening also, you're making them realize that what kind of soil is required by a particular plant, or how much water do we need to give, what is the effect of the season on the growth of the plants. Like in winters, they are little sloppy and they are not growing too much. So these are the kind of things which the child is going to understand and learn by doing. So that's one essence, and that's something which is leading to a better things. Moving further, socially useful productive labor is inherent in educational activities. So the only purpose or the only work which has to be done by the teachers or the curriculum developers is that we need to take out that inherent part of the educational activity. So it is already there. We just need to understand and we need to induce that kind of environment that we are using or engaging in those kind of activities. Now, if you are not, you are hampering the child's growth because you are giving them a half cut down experience. You are not giving them a fully enriched experience. So if you intend to give that kind of thing, and even at the level of a school, individual level of a school teacher, one can do a lot in this regard. So even the science teaching is going to be easier if you are engaging in work education. So because education is about all the topics to be covered, and this is just for our benefit that we divide them into different subjects. Otherwise, we are talking in terms of knowledge. Now, if you intend to give a certain knowledge, we need to understand that all these aspects of knowledge, the different categories of the subjects which we have made, they have been made only for the easier comprehension by the students, and not that they have to be treated like that only. So one needs to understand that useful physical labor is something which is inherent to the educational activities. Also, it has to be seen that it's an essential significant factor in the learning processes. So it is not to be treated as something extra or something desirable, but it has to be understood as that it is something significant factor in the learning process. So it is not something desirable, it is something which is required in the whole process. Now, if we understand the work education in this comprehensive sense, we are going to have a better understanding of how this work education can be implemented in the school curriculum or in the general day-to-day life of the students. Now, we need to see that it is visible in the form of useful services and productive work for the community. Now, how is work education visible? It's visible in the form of useful service and productive work for the community. So, if a school is engaging in, let's say, they are cleaning the area around them, probably they have adopted a village or they have adopted a small community, or probably if the school is not that large, or probably the society around is not that large, you can even adopt a street and you are just engaging in a cleaning of that street also. The way the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan has been proposed and the way the school children have been involved in that process, it's very clear that these kind of efforts can be started from the school level, and then it's going to have a longer impact on the society or on the community. So it's going to be a form of useful services and productive work for the community. Also, it has to be treated as an essential factor with all the aspects of education in multi-level education system. See, the kind of education system we have is a multi-level education system. You have classes and then you have higher classes and then you have the senior secondary classes. So there is this levels which have been formed in the education system. And work education is going to be an essential factor because it's going to bind all those levels also, and it's an essential factor in understanding different aspects of education in that multi-level system also. So that's why it becomes essential that we all as teachers appreciate, understand first, and then we can appreciate how we can involve or we can implement work education in our school system or in our education system. Moving further, since we have understood what is the concept of work, what is the concept of work education, and how is it important to the educational life of the children, we need to see what are the factors which are essential for the successful work education. definitely, if you need to involve or if you want to start with something new or if you want any other kind of idea to be implemented completely, you need to have certain factors which are associated with that system or which are conducive to that system, and that would help in the implementation of that kind of thing. Now, similar is with work education also. Now, if you want work education to be successful in your system, one needs to understand the factors which are going to be responsible for it or which can aid it or help it. The number one factor would be the broad-mindedness. Broad-mindedness in the sense that you need to have people who are broad-minded, and the set of people who are broad-minded is not just going to be the teachers who are going to be there. Even the parents need to be broad-minded, even the school community, the management needs to be broad-minded, and even the students need to be made broad-minded. Now, what I mean, or how do I explain, or how do you understand why do they need to be broad-minded? Because see, in our society, what has been happening is that we generally associate some kind of importance to certain kind of work and some kind of de-importance to certain kinds of work. So, physical labor is generally not something seen to be something desirable or something which we aspire to do. We do not want our children who are going to the schools, we generally want them to be prepared for the white collar jobs. So, they do not dirty themselves and they are not involved in physical labor. So, here the parents need to understand that we need to realize that we need to be broad-minded to understand that work education has to be a part of it. Now, let's say there is this one condition in which the school, this is just an example from my child's life only, that the school intended to do a cleaning day. They decided that last Saturday of a school is going to be the cleaning day. So, they said that the children are going to bring their aprons and their children are going to wear the gloves and they are going to clean the school in whatever corners they would be allotted to. Now, there were a lot of parents who objected to, and they said that why do our children need to do that kind of thing? You must be having sweepers and you must be having other housekeeping labor with yourself. So, you shouldn't be doing that kind of thing. But then the school made them realize that it's not just for the sake of cleaning, but it's leading to other things also. So, the parents need to be really broad-minded to accept that kind of thing, that these kind of activities will be done in the school or in the education system. Another factor which contributes to significant work education is dignity of labor and positive attitude. So, this dignity of labor needs to be realized by all. By parents, by school authorities, and by the children alike. So, all the three who are the basic stakeholders here, they need to understand that there is a dignity of labor with any kind of physical labor which is being done. So, if that sweeper is cleaning the roads, he is engaging in some kind of physical labor, the child needs to understand that there is an importance attached to it. Now, what happens when you do not attach that kind of importance to the kind of physical labor the person is engaging in? The kind of behavior you are going to have with that individual is going to be different. We generally consider them that they are lower on the socioeconomic strata, but then we do realize wrongly think that kind of thing, that they are lower in the standard also, or they are lower contributors to the society also. In fact, they are the ones who are major contributors to the society, because they are the ones who are going to help us in living a normal life. So, dignity of labor and a positive attitude for any kind of physical work needs to be appreciated in children and needs to be inculcated in the children. And this is going to happen only if, again, we come down to the first factor, if there is going to be broad-mindedness about it, if they are going to engage in some kind of physical labor, and if they are going to discuss about these kind of things. So, these two factors are there. There are more factors. Another factor is a positive relationship between the community and the school needs to be built on. If there is going to be a positive relationship between community and school, the community is going to understand the school better and the school is going to understand the community better. So, this will help them both to have a positive relationship. If the society or the community which is just outside the school is wary of the school, they are not very comfortable with the way the school is working, they are not going to have an open-mindedness about the way the school wants to contribute to the society. And it's on the other way around also. If the school doesn't feel that they are having a positive community around or a supportive community around, then they also do that same kind of thing. They do not take the suggestions from the community. So, to have a positive relationship between community and school is going to be another factor which is going to be very beneficial for successful work education. Another factor which contributes to the same is the feeling of cooperation which is felt among the individuals, Again, individuals here means the community, the school, the parents, everybody around, all the stakeholders of the education system. If they feel that kind of cooperation is there, they are going to be more open about it and they are going to understand each other better and they will be helpful in to each other. Coming down to the last factor, which is again but last but not the least factor, that there needs to be an imaginative and creative aptitude for making work education successful. Because if there is going to be creativity associated with it, the children are not going to feel the burden of the physical labor. See, most of our children these days, they do not enjoy any kind of physical labor. So if that is, if creativity is introduced in there, then they are not going to feel the burden of the work education and then they are going to enjoy more, learn more and benefit from it more. Now, just having a wind up of whatever things we were trying to discuss today, we were understanding what is work education and what are the different factors which are making work education successful. And let's just understand that it is work education which is having a effect on the regular habits and positive attitudes to fulfill the basic needs of the society. So, if that kind of importance is being realized by each one of us, we may be in the different spheres of the education system. One may be the teachers, the other may be the school authorities, the parents, everybody around. But then we all need to have that kind of thing and we all desire to that have to have that kind of thing, that we have a productive society and our education system should meet the basic needs of the society. So, it's work education is something which sensitizes and it brings awareness towards the dignity of labor in the society. If there is going to be dignity of labor and we are going to respect each kind of work which is being done by different individuals, we are going to have a better, comfortable, productive society in the sense that the relations are also going to be better. And not just that the physical labor is helping the society make better, even if the relationships are better, it makes the society more productive, more conducive to each other. Now, that's what is work education. And I hope you are going to all appreciate that we need to imbibe some kind of work education in our system so that our children are more sensitive and our society becomes more beneficial and productive to all the individuals of the society and not just for a certain section of the society. Thank you all.